There is increasing data on the use of subcutaneous ICD, but its role in day-to-day practice remains to be seen. So let us just start with, why do you need a subcutaneous ICD? You need a subcutaneous ICD because you need a less invasive solution for patients at risk of sudden death. Right now, we are implanting ICDs with the generator pack which is placed in the abdomen, the generator pack which is placed in the prepectoral region, and this is the new one where you're placing the generator pack in the region of the axilla. Now, contrasting the abdominal generator pack where the leads are placed on the epicardium, not entering the blood cavity, with that of the typical transvenous ICD where the leads are entering the vasculature. Finally, the subcutaneous ICD system where the leads themselves are subcutaneous. Why do we need it? We need it because transvenous ICD complications, both acute and chronic, are more prevalent in the real world than what we see in registries or in trials. There is a 15.5% risk of some complication or the other which occurs at 6 years. Most complications in young ICD patients less than the age of 65. And why I have chosen 65 is because the average life expectancy in India is 68 years. So all of us are going to be young patients if we ever need ICDs. They are a result of lead failure in 10%, lead placement issues in another 6.5%, and 3% of these patients have the risk of infection. Transvenous ICDs also do not outlive these patients. That is to say that we will always live longer than what the subcutaneous, than what the transvenous ICD lead life is. So these young patients, patients less than the age of 65, are at a higher risk of lead complications, and as I mentioned, they survived longer than the life of the transvenous leads. The risk of transvenous lead complication increases by about 2% per year, and age less than the age of 65 is an independent predictor of transvenous lead failure. So this journey of the subcutaneous ICD started nearly in the year 2000. It went through its initial FDA CE mark study for with 55 patients. Then you have the investigational device exemption trial, that is the effortless trial, which contained about 321 patients, plus the registry, which went out up to 985 patients. And now finally here, we are near 2016 to 18, where the post-approval studies are recruiting patients. Which patients should you do these devices in? We should do these devices in patients who have no venous access, because it's a subcutaneous device, doesn't need venous access. Patients who are at a high risk of complications from transvenous devices. That could mean patients who have CRTs, perhaps. If the CRT is not determined to be significant enough to contribute to their survival, that is patients who are either immunocompromised, patients who are on dialysis, patients with channelopathies, where there is no indication for pacing, and patients with previous device infections or lead failures with or without a history of endocarditis. You have to strongly consider it, as I mentioned before, for young patients, life expectancy of patients more than 10 years, because the typical transvenous lead lasts for about 7 to 8 years, patients who are primary prevention patients, ischemic or non-ischemic, patients with prosthetic tricuspid valves, where you really don't want to cross the tricuspid valve with an ICD lead, and putting it in the coronary sinus is not an option. Women, because you don't want them to have poor thresholds, which is common in women. And select secondary patients. This is a very soft indication. It is contraindicated in any patient having systolic heart failure with a left bundle branch block, because they would do better with a CRT-D. Symptomatic bradycardia or need for pacing, if it is there at any point in time, do not consider subcutaneous ICD. If you are having recurrent monomorphic VT, and as we all know, monomorphic VT terminates with anti-tachycardia pacing. In these patients, if you give subcutaneous ICDs, they will have multiple shocks without any other means to terminate the tachycardia, and the patient will have post-traumatic stress disorder. Finally, those patients who fail the screening for a subcutaneous ICD. I'll just come to that in a minute. Now, this is how a typical subcutaneous ICD looks. On the left is a subcutaneous ICD. You can see this coil of the subcutaneous ICD placed in the parasternal region. This uniquely has been placed on the right side of the sternum. Normally, you have it on the left side of the sternum, and the can, which is in the axilla. The connection between the can and this ICD lead is via a tunneled course, where you pull the lead through that tunnel and implant it here. Compare that to a typical ICD, a transvenous ICD, which is on the right side. Its can is present in the prepectoral region subcutaneously, and you have these two coils which are placed within the venous system. On a matter of note, I would just like to tell everybody here, stop using dual coil transvenous ICD leads. They do not give you any benefit, and they are a nightmare to extract. Just a segue off. If you look at the cross-sectional view or the lateral view for the subcutaneous ICD, you can see that you have a true antero-posterior location. The can is here, whereas the leads or the shocking coil is anterior. Compare that to a badly placed, in my opinion, transvenous ICD, where you have all of them in more or less nearly the same plane. So you don't have a typical antero-posterior coverage of the heart with the defibrillation or the vector. Do you have effective defibrillation without transvenous leads? Yes, you do. It's comparable to that with the transvenous ICD at nearly 98.2%, but without the risk of transvenous lead issues. When you do pooled data analysis, there is zero cardiac injury, unless somebody becomes very adventurous and tries to poke the heart from there, and there is no systemic blood infections or endocarditis. What is the advantage in technology? The battery life is slightly higher at 7.3 years. It has better SVT versus VT discrimination. There is better monitoring of atrial fibrillation, and there is MRI compatibility. So what are the vectors in a subcutaneous ICD? On a typical subcutaneous ICD, you have what is called as a primary vector, which is between the can and the base of this coil. Then you have something which is called as an alternate vector, which is from point A to point B, across. And finally, you have what is called the alternate vector, which is between point A, that the tip of the coil, and the can itself. Again, compare that to a transvenous ICD, where you have the vectors between the tip of the coil and the can, with or without the SVC lead in place. Now, we talked about screening. What is this screening? So, depending on the three vectors that we've programmed or we talked about for the subcutaneous ICD, it is going to be looking at our heart. And unlike the transvenous lead, you are going to have a QRS and a T wave. That is the catch. The T wave, when located in each of these combinations, can seem different. And it is critical for us to have at least one lead where the ratio between the QRS and the T wave is not as low as 1.6. Because if you do that, the device will be not able to sense a proper QRS and it will oversense the T wave. So how do you do screening? You have this screening tool where first you correspond the heart rate of the patient, which is seen on point A. You look at the morphology of the QRS in the appropriate location of this particular stencil that is given. When you look at the stencil, you've got to make sure that the QRS peak is not above this dotted line. It is instead within the dotted line above. It can cross the dotted line below, but it need not be below the stencil. So after you've chosen the correct stencil for the appropriate heart rate at the time of screening, then you try and see if the T wave fits in the contours of the stencil. If the T wave comes outside the contour of the stencil, that lead is unacceptable for purposes of use. Now remember, we had three different vectors. We need to place the electrodes at those relative locations and measure the QRS to T ratio and find at least one lead where that is possible. We need to do this at three different gains, namely 5, 10, and 20, in standing position and in sleeping position. so that we do not have any chances of oversensing. These are the examples of the location of the leads that we place our screening tools at. Now, what are the chances of failure? Nearly 8%. And patients who have T inversions in the inferior leads have nearly a 45% chance of failing this screening test. So, Okamura et al. Decided that in patients with congenital heart disease, can we do the screening on the right side instead of the left side? And it was found that it increased the efficacy of screening if you do it on the right side. Now, implantation, we briefly touched upon it. You make a pocket in the subcutaneous tissue in the mid-axillary line. You place the device scan there. Then you tunnel from the lateral end of the chest wall in the precordium to the medial end and pull in this lead through that. After that, you have two options. Either you make an incision here in the inferior part and suture the sleeve here, and make an incision in the top part and suture the sleeve there. That is the three incision technique. Or you can just say that I'm confident enough and suture it in the inferior part here and not do an incision here. This implantation typically can be done without fluoroscopy. While programming, you want to program the VF zone greater than 220 and the VT zone at around about 180. SVT discriminators are usually programmed on and off, and no additional programming is possible. And newly, they have found a noise algorithm to help find out pectoral muscle noise. This is a typical example of the device working. This is a subcutaneous ICD implanted. You can see at the beginning of the strip, you have some polymorphic PVCs which are seen, which sets off this polymorphic VT. It takes about 6 to 18 seconds, that's around 15 seconds to detect the rhythm and shocks it. Once tachycardia detection and shocking has happened, there's a brief period of bradycardia pacing that lasts for a maximum of 30 seconds, followed by an intrinsic rhythm which goes on. These are the small intrinsic waves which you can see. Now, why is the device pacing in spite of these waves? Because it's unable to sense these small QRSs. Look at this device function. If you can see closely, this is basically a lot of noise. And the rhythm seems to be sinus. Because there was an improperly placed device, there was T wave oversensing here, and the patient got shocked. This is one of the major reasons why patients fail a subcutaneous ICD, or a subcutaneous ICD has to be extracted within 2 weeks of implantation. A similar episode here, where there has been T wave oversensing, but that is because the can has migrated from the point of implantation more anteriorly, which has then caused the vector to become abnormal. Registry data for these patients was shown, and you can see that there was freedom from any complications in nearly 98% of patients. Inappropriate shock values were seen in 98.5%. And the shock efficacy was nearly 97%. It was particularly effective in patients with channelopathies, which is where we are targeting these devices for. A meta-analysis done by Basure et al. Showed that there was lesser lead complications when comparing transvenous ICDs to subcutaneous ICDs. The infection rates were similar. There were similar device failures, but critically, inappropriate shock rates were also similar. If we go into the details of why the inappropriate shock rates were also similar, it is because in transvenous ICD, there was more inappropriate shock rates due to SVTs, but in subcutaneous ICDs, there was more inappropriate shock rates because of oversensing. So again, it is critical that we screen these patients properly before putting in the device, else they will get inappropriately shocked. MRI compatibility we've already touched upon. It's 1.5 Tesla MR conditional, and this is a simple programmer interface where the patient can go in and get his MRI done despite the device in place. The newer technology to reduce T wave oversensing has decreased by 82% the risk of T wave oversensing, and it also gives us superior SVT or AF discrimination. Finally, there is a learning curve for physicians adopting the s-icd. Initial complication rates will decrease from about 9.8 to 5.4%. Inappropriate shock rates decrease with the newer two-zone programming. And procedure time is approximately 65 minutes after an experience period of 13 implants. The learning curve also results in systemic infection being the commonest cause of complications, as well as discomfort in the axillary region because of the footprint of the generator. Future directions, we need to be careful with T-wave oversensing. There is no pacing backup, so efforts are being made to incorporate leadless pacemaker technology and allow it to communicate with the subcutaneous ICD to enable pacing backup. And finally, in obese patients, please be careful that you put the device generator on the fascia, on the muscle, rather than in the fat itself. Summary, it's a disruptive technology because it gives you ICD benefits without transvenous access. It is better for patients without pacing leads, in younger patients, and in those patients who are expected to live longer than 10 years. It needs careful screening of patients, and that alone is the single most important thing for the success of this technology.